thank you everyone for being here today, and thank you so much to Jessica and to the Institute for the invitation. It is an honor and a privilege to be here and to share the work with these two eminent colleagues. So I was just talking to Denise, and I was saying that I'm changing the narrative completely because we've been talking about the brain, but I'm here to talk about the mind. As a cognitive linguist, I look on to the studies that colleagues of mine do with fMRI and with brain scannings, but I don't scan brains. I pick them to see how they learn better. So I'm a senior lecturer at Columbia University, and I teach. I'm a weird figure in academia because I have the privilege of being both a linguist, an applied linguist, and a language instructor, which is not common at all. So if you were saying, Gigi, before that the fields of neuroscience and pedagogy or education are not very connected, you would think that linguistics and language learning are fields that are connected, but I'm here to tell you no. That is unfortunately not the case at all. And linguists look down on teachers because, you know, we have to teach with a curriculum, and we have exams, we have a syllabus to cover, and we have a lot of things. And then teachers look down on linguists because linguists have never set foot in a classroom. So what are you going to tell me about language learning when, you know, I have papers to grade and I have things to do, and you actually don't know the first thing about actual teaching and actual learning in action in the classroom. So bridging the gap between linguistics and language learning, it's tricky. So I have the advantage of doing both things. So whenever I talk about cognitive linguistics, it's because I study as a linguist and I know the theory, but I also am an instructor of Spanish. So whatever I do with the theory, I apply in the classroom. So I know firsthand the things that work and the things that don't work. Because otherwise it'd be hard to bridge both worlds. So, applied cognitive linguistics and language learning. So a brief introduction first on language teaching, or I actually wanted to survey the audience here a little bit. Any language instructors in the group? Okay, great, okay, oh, a lot of you. Any linguists in the group? Any both? Yay, okay, great, so you're weird like me, that's awesome. We can be unique together, that's great. So then, you know, you agree with, hopefully you agree with most of the things that that I just said, that it's hard to bridge that gap between linguistic theory and language pedagogy. So the disconnect between linguistic theory and actual teaching in the classroom is very big. And there are papers in SLA, for example, semi-recent 2015 paper by Diane Lansing Freeman, researching precisely this, and then writing a very long paper on there is, you know, the link between linguists and applied linguists and teachers, but also publishers and the companies responsible for printing the books, the textbooks that we teach with. There's a huge disconnect because, you know, in cognitive linguistics, for instance, we're big on image and we work on visual, we work with visual representations, and then the publishers say, well, that's very expensive to print so many images in color. So it's very domestic, it's very dirty, it's very all about the money, but it is the truth. So what we get is that between linguistic research and results in linguistic research and language pedagogy, it takes years and years and years for whatever findings to make their way down, trickle their way down to textbooks. So what we're doing, the people who are doing both things, is just bringing our own materials and teaching our own way in the classroom and doing some research, and hopefully with the research that we're doing and the positive results that we're getting, that will come to pass. In the textbooks. Fortunately, in the field of Spanish as a foreign and second language, that's already partly a reality. And I and if anyone is interested in the Spanish case, I can give some references of textbooks that are already incorporating these things. But for now, in the big majority of textbooks for grammar, what we have is a notional functional curriculum. So it is the introduction, where the introduction of grammar stems from a need to basis. So unit one, what do you need to say? And then regarding the sphere of linguistic content, then you get the grammar inserted into that. That's very ad hoc, very ad hoc. So what grammar will fill that need that you have to communicate? Grammar is largely an object of study in the language classroom, and despite claims of communicative purposes and the task-based instruction and collaborative learning and everything, we still are doing foreign object a study of grammar, and there's a complete absence of the students L1 or L1s. You come into the Spanish classroom, for instance, and that's all you get. You can only do Spanish because we're trying to mimic an immersion context, and so why would you bring English into the classroom? And that's counterproductive, and that is a lot of the lore that goes around in language classrooms, and then you get reviewed by peers who think that way, and there's discussion happens, no? Debate happens. So there is no interlinguistic motivation, there's no interlinguistic reflection, they're largely absent from the classroom, and it's just you're learning Spanish, and it is truly a foreign language for your students. Then you have form versus meaning versus use, so you do have a disconnect, especially with the verbal system where you learn how it's conjugated, what a verb tense is, and then how it's conjugated, what it means, and then when it is used. So you have a trifecta for disaster, really, because the usage goes separately, appears at different stages of the curriculum, and you'll hear me come back to the conditional. But in Spanish, the conditional, and in English too, is a past tense. But students learn that the conditional is a past tense at the advanced level for the first time ever. Whereas the conditional already appears at the elementary levels, but it appears in completely different contexts for like wishes and hypotheses and desires and courtesy and pragmatics and everything. And then by the time they get to the indirect speech in the advanced level, they're like, oh, but it is a past tense. It's like, wow. And then they have this aha moment when they're already at the advanced level, which is a waste of time. So they never get to connect all the uses of the conditional from the idea that it is a past tense. And if we did that from the beginning, it would make a lot more sense because then learning would be a lot more holistic. But this is not what happens in the large majority of textbooks in the market. And grammar is always and always has been the apple of discord. So teachers, the publishers, the linguists, there's the last 50 years or the last 30 years has seen so much improvement in methodology and the need to teach culture, the need to teach language and content together, the need to manage the skills, the pedagogical translation, the not only the four skills but also mediation and translation. And there's been so much progress being made on how we teach, but what remains a battlefield and the students remain as collateral damage, it's for grammar. That nothing has changed, and it doesn't matter how progressive the new textbooks are, you still have your grammar section, and you still have your foreign language of study, where you get a lot of syntax and a lot of morphology, and I don't know in Canada how that works, probably more like in Europe, where students are very much aware of meta language, and they're very much aware of syntax, and they know what a subordinate clause is, maybe? No? Not really? Okay. Because in the United States, nothing at all.
Because here there is a different culture about grammar teaching in French, and in the English programs in Quebec, it's no grammar.
It's no grammar. But
so
in French,
English teachers will tell French teachers, if you think that I'm going to teach grammar so that I can help you with teaching grammar in French, forget it.
Okay.
So you know what is a preposition in French, but the students won't know that there are prepositions in English.
Yes. So, okay, so you're not faring any better on
this.
But see, but grammar is still a battlefield. But we, across the curriculum, English and French and Spanish, we would all agree about the importance of a authentic materials and culture and blah, blah, blah. But whenever it comes to grammar, it's a mess. So the current panoramic that we have is pretty weak. And in large portions of schools where Spanish is being taught, this is what we get. Very, 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 very much this object of study, which clashes with the access of better language and the knowledge of the students of linguistic words. So what I would like to talk about today is that cognitive linguistics is what is disrupting the status quo of the understanding and the learning of grammar in the foreign and second language classroom. And this is what I would like to sell to this audience today. So let's see. Just to give you an index of relevant concepts we're going to be talking about, because I was just discussing also with Denise how difficult it is when you have interdisciplinary audiences, how much jargon and how much meta-language on the field people manage. So just to have some of the words that will come up, I have actually highlighted them also as they come into the presentation, but these are terms that come from cognitive linguistics and the field of cognitive linguistics applied to language pedagogy. Let's see. So the very, very, very fundamental of cognitive linguistics, and then when it applies to language learning, it's even more important, is that language is space. And language arises from the physical interaction of human beings with the physical world. So Davey in 2001 was already saying that one of our earliest and most basic cognitive achievements as infants is to acquire understanding of objects and of the way in which they relate to each other in physical space. So way before speaking, children can do one basic communicating function, which is to point. They point. They use their index finger and they point, and they know what far is, they know what near is, they spend hours under, when they're lying in their, what's that called, una? Cradle? Yeah. When they're lying in their cradle, they're looking at the mobile, and they're looking at, you know, how it moves around, and there's music, and there are colors, and they just decode space from the, way before they even start decoding language. So they recognize sounds and they recognize language, but they don't actively use it, but they do actively decode and see and understand space. So examples of everyday language. So we are all very close in my family, and who here knows my family? Nobody, of course. But I can tell you, I can use an adjective that has to do with space, and I can give you the idea of closeness, and closeness is also warmth. When somebody's close, you can feel their body heat, and that's just a pleasant feeling. So all of that takes me to use a spatial-based word and an experiential-based word so that you guys understand, even without not knowing my family at all, what kind of relationship I have with them. Or I can say, I don't know why you're so distant with me, and by using another spatially related term, you can also understand what I'm talking about, what I'm feeling, what I'm going through. He was bursting with joy, there's not enough space, so it comes out. Person, the body is a container, cannot contain. Or her running pace is glacial, very, 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 very slow. And everyone has seen the movie Shrek, I would hope. Yes? Good. If you haven't, you go watch it. It's fun. So in this movie, if you remember, Shrek rescues the princess in the name of Lord Farquaad. And Lord Farquaad has one very specific physical quality, and it's that he's very short. But she doesn't know this. So when she's trying to convince Shrek and Donkey to talk about Lord Farquaad, they start saying, you know, there are some who think that he doesn't measure up. Or that he is, that there are those who think little of him. And they just start laughing at these little jokes that she doesn't get at all, because we're so used to metaphorical uses and metaphorical appearances of words that when they become literal is when there is an actual reaction, in this case, humor. And the scene is the more funny because Fiona is not at all understanding language in a literal way. She's understanding language in a metaphorical way. And those two are not. So that's what makes it very funny. So let's see. Cognitive linguistics, then, as I said, arises from the space, our own body, the experience, and this is what creates the term embodiment. So we say that languages embody everything in the language. Is representational of our five senses, our body, the way we move, the way we stand in the world, and our own two feet. And this has a direct impact on grammar. And there's an entire section, entire subfield of cognitive linguistics that works with the thinking for speaking hypothesis that posits that you will understand the word. It's, you guys remember Sapir and Whorf and how, you know, language and culture and how that was debunked years later. Well, cognitive linguistics, what it does is it recycles a lot of the most, you know, the greatest hits of linguistics, I would say. So what thinking for speaking says, okay, well, language doesn't determine thought, but your language does determine the way you understand the world, because your language has a syntactic and a semantic and a way to function in the structure that it has, and you are constrained by that structure with how you process the world and how you, after processing, communicate that understanding to the rest of the world. So the field of linguistic typology and how Spanish and English, for instance, belong to two completely, Spanish and French belong to the same one, and English belongs to a completely different linguistic typology family. So the way all these languages conceive and see motion and process motion and communicate motion is completely different. And cannot be equated at all. So the thinking for speaking hypothesis says that your thought is your thought, and your understanding and your conceptualization of the world is the same, but the construal, so the actual words that you use to talk about the world, will be constrained by the structure of the language that you speak. So your discourse community, we will affect how you speak. So yes, every speaker is unique, of course, but we all have this common understanding because we belong to a discourse community. And I will not say a native language, and I will not say a language, because as you have mentioned too, Spanish has, you know, Spanish from Colombia, the Spanish from Spain, the Spanish from the United States. They're, you know, they're discourse communities other than, you know, instead of just a language, right? I'm sure you can agree with French as well. You know, the French in France and the French here, it's like they're different. So this has like these little arrows, but it's more like a it's more a holistic circular process. So the speakers are at the core of communication. They conceptualize, they create language from their own experiences, and then when they have done that, they assign meaning to linguistic words. And this creates a motivated selection of words to express meanings with a communicative intent. So motivation in cognitive linguistics doesn't mean being hyped about something. Motivation in cognitive linguistics means that you have a reason for selecting and choosing that particular word and not other to inform your communicative intent. So what you have in mind will be, you will try to choose the best word possible for that, and because you do that, you have conceptualized and you have assigned meaning to that. So that creates communication that's usage-based, which is one of the biggest tenets of cognitive linguistics, and that's why also in cognitive linguistics we work with corpus linguistics a lot. We work with corpora because whatever the textbook says or whatever the grammar of the Royal Academy of blah blah says, if the speakers are saying it, it goes. So communication is usage-based because speakers are at the core, because they conceptualize the world, because they assign meaning to the linguistic forms, and because they have a communicative intent that they choose consciously or unconsciously those words to express what they want to say, and that creates usage-based. So it is a circular process. So more on that. This is my niece, Claudia. She's 12 now. But I've been using this photo ever since I first saw it, because I thought it was wonderful. She's angry. She's very mad. And if you have children, I don't, but I have enough nieces and nephews to know this as a fact. She's very angry because she's constrained. she cannot go and explore and put things in her mouth and, you know, eat everything on her path. And she's very frustrated because language and human experience is experiential. That's redundant, but it's true. So it arises from physical interaction with the world, and it permeates the linguistic system and the grammatical structure that it has. So motion and physics and the space and the five senses, and that's why kids get so frustrated when they can't move around, because they are decoding the world around them. If you just think, you don't hear, and this is really pretty and everything, but it gets boring quickly, and then she wants to go and explore more and understand more of the world. So if this is what babies are doing from second one and day one, it makes a lot of sense that that would impact the way language functions and the way language works. And then when you want to bring this to the language classroom, it makes a lot of sense. It makes you wonder why everyone is not working with this. Well, we're working on it. So embodied aspects in the language, they facilitate communication and they bridge the gap between the first language and the second language, or between the languages that our learners speak. So the speakers, what they do is they create language from that sensory motor experience in space, and they assign the meaning to the concepts, and that is the motivation that I just talked about. And then this is what figures here. So metaphors are not figures of speech in literature, which is where I first studied them ever at school. Metaphors and metonymies and oxymorons and all these figures of, they're like rhetorical figures, and they are studied in literature. When you study poetry, you study metaphor. But actually, metaphors are cognitive operations of the first order, and our mind cannot function, and our mind cannot bridge the gap between the language of the mind, which goes at the speed of light, and the actual language that you speak. And there's gotta be somewhere to bridge all of that that goes in your head and the words that you choose. It has happened to all of us, right? That you have an idea in your mind and it's very clear, but then when you like try to put it in words, you can't. And that is the disconnect between thought and language. They don't go at the same time. So metaphor is the biggest ally that the mind has to come out as language, as actual language. So in Spanish, we say llegar a una conclusión. In English, it is to reach a conclusion. So what are we doing? There is motion. So we are using space to and relatable experiential knowledge of the world to relate something as complicated as a thought process that has an end. So you have motion and you have a goal. And when you are done, then you reach your goal or you arrive at your goal. So language is always motivated. It has a why. It arises from physical experience, and it's very easy to see in that close and distant and glacial and bursting, or this example that I just gave you. But it goes a lot deeper, and it permeates the most fine-grained aspects of grammatical structure. So it permeates syntax, and it permeates morphological aspects as well. So, disruptive concepts that cognitive linguistics uses to break with traditional instruction. The first one is conceptualization, and it matters. Conceptualization matters because our understanding of the world directly affects our language structure. So if I say my friend went out, everyone understands that my friend was here and then my friend exited. So because that is relatable, known physical experience, I can then transfer that to more abstract and more, I don't know, random concepts such as that I went out. So I can teach my students to say go out means to leave, or it means to have, you know, lack of electricity or something, which is what we get in our textbooks. And this is what we get in language learning and language teaching. We get lists of vocabulary. When I was learning English, I didn't learn phrasal verbs in a meaningful manner at all. I had a list of 90 and I memorized them, period. I turned out okay. I used them. So our students will always learn. What I say to teachers of Spanish when I give teacher training seminars, is that there's no miracle cure. There is no miracle methodology that's gonna come and solve all the problems of the world. But more meaningful ways to go about teaching and learning a language, and cognitive linguistics provides one of them. So what I want to do is create less randomness in the perception that the students have of grammatical and lexical constructions. And I want to give them an awareness of motivated meaning. I want to give them an awareness of linguistic form has always a meaning. So I can say, I'm going to class, which is literally, I am moving in space to go to a place, or I am going to study, where I transfer metaphorically and I create figurative language and say, okay, motion is intention. And then what I'm going to say is, I'm going to study, I'm not going anywhere. I'm just expressing a plan. I'm just creating, setting an intention, and the way I do that is by using a verbal motion. So this helps the student a lot with conceptualization, and they start understanding that that language is always meaningful, which is something that is not a given in language class, in foreign language class. So embodiment figures, because it makes communication more understandable and relatable within discourse communities. You know, if language is based in physical experience, we all have physical experiences, so there's more that unite us than more than separates us. Which is, you know, the preposition and the phrasal verbs. I wish I would have learned phrasal verbs in a more motivated manner that would tell me that the verb to look, you know, it's just to look. But then when you look up, you create, you with the preposition up, you already create a hierarchy. And what is higher, because we have the conceptual metaphor of more is up, you automatically create a structure that's above you. And then when you use the preposition to, which is also motivated for a goal that you're looking at, you look up to something, you create the hierarchy of more, up is more is up, and then you also create the very specific target-like stare. So you get to admire somebody. That translates into admiration. It makes a lot of sense, but back then I just learned to admire, look up to. And it was years and years and years before I was aware of this. So what I want to do is create awareness of motivated meaning when I teach language. Usage base prevails. So textbooks don't create the language. Speakers do. So actually, with teaching Spanish, because the varieties of Spanish are so different, you may teach something and then there's a hand that goes up. And teachers just get a cold bead of sweat just down the back. Because somebody's gonna, you know, somebody's gonna say, but I've heard this. Or like, my friend from Colombia says this, and you're like, yeah. So if you abide by the textbook and you're not aware of a usage-based approach to language, then you're in constant conflict with the textbook and in constant conflict with the student. Whereas if you say, okay, well, tell me more, and then you can go to, if you don't work with the COCAP corpus, you can always go to Google and just search, because Google is your friend for corpus linguistics. So look it up, take a look, you know, be okay with that. But if you're aware of usage-based approaches to language, then you're not so tense in your language class all the time, because there's always a counterexample, always. And it's just, you get itchy from thinking about it. And this is the thinking for speaking I was mentioning before. This is also a very disruptive concept. So linguistic typology will affect this vision and motion. So in English, you say, he ran out of the room, right? And you have a verb where manner of motion is to run. And then you get your trajectories via prepositions. So he ran out of the room, and you can even say things like he ran up the stairs, out the room, into the hallway, out to the street. If you speak Spanish, if some of you speak Spanish, how many verbs do you need to say that very same thing? Like, there's no way. Your language does not afford you, Spanish does not afford you the ability to say that at all. Because in Spanish, what we have is verbs that have trajectories. So subir, to go up. Salir, to exit, to run, correr, but that you can't use one manner of motion and then all the trajectories in one. You need different verbs. So, subió las escaleras, salió a la calle, entró al pasillo, fue, it doesn't work at all that way. So, if you're aware of thinking for speaking, then you can teach that in a motivated manner. And you can teach that in a very specific way. I was teaching elementary one this semester, which people might think, oh, that's the easy level. that's the worst of them all. That's the most difficult of them all, the elementary one. And we come to unit 7, which is the last one of the semester. We're done, thankfully. But we have directions, and we have the study of directions. And students say to go up in Spanish, the ir arriba, which we understand, but we don't say because we have subir. We have a trajectory embedded in the verb. So a lot of teachers who are not aware of the thinking for speaking patterns of different satellite versus verb-based languages, they struggle. Teachers struggle with this a lot, and students struggle with this because they say, wait, but it's so straightforward. It's like to go up, sweep. It's like, no, the thinking for speaking patterns are different, and therefore the vision of motion is completely different. They are speaking from two different worlds. We are speaking from two different worlds, and you have to have explicit instruction on that. Otherwise, it's very difficult. And they don't get, they know prepositions, but they don't get that salir needs a preposition. Because when you exit, but you exit from a place or you exit to a place, you exit with someone, you need those prepositions there to tell you what the relationships are between the verb and the agents and the active participants in the verb. But English doesn't do that. It does when you go at it from the Latin perspective, and then they have ascent, which they understand, and then they're like, oh, elevate, and then elevator, and then they make all these connections, but because their language has a verb-based influence from French back in the day. But the more English they speak, the less it resembles Spanish in the communication of motion. So there's gotta be teachers need to be aware of this. Otherwise, it's elementary one, but it feels like an advanced level task. And then there are studies that show that that's highly fossilized, and that students say subida ir arriba all the time, and they don't say subir. and then they say ir afuera, and they don't say salir. Even at the very advanced levels. So let's see. Language is symbolic. This is one of the main tenets of cognitive linguistics. So form and meaning cannot be separated. So forget about how it's formed, how it's used, and what it means when teaching the verbal system. That doesn't work. The disconnect never works. So this is a yin and yang view of language all the time. They cannot be separated. They inform each other. And because language is representational of reality and of physical reality, there is always a connection between the two. So this is a very disruptive idea as well. So we come to the metaphorical competence, which is one of the biggest allies of a project like yours, for instance. You have to bring metaphorical competence into the language through content classroom, or the language classroom itself. So the 1980s publication of Metaphors We Live by Lakoff and Johnson was a game changer in understanding how language works. And it wasn't that long ago, but it was a long time coming. And it has to do with generative versus cognitive approaches to language. And because you know that in linguistics, you're either for Chomsky or you're against Chomsky. And there's this, it's Chomsky is the center of the universe in modern linguistics. So these guys went against Chomsky, and then it took them that long. So metaphors explain complex concepts by easily accessible images. That's why metaphors are the biggest allies of the mind when trying to select language. Because the speaker is influenced by that sensorimotor experience in space, we assign the meaning to the concept, and then what we use, when we use metaphors, what we do is express the abstract, which is called a target domain, and I'll demonstrate in a minute, with concrete language, which is a source, it's called a source domain. So when you have very abstract and very difficult to relate concepts that are in your mind and that only you understand, you're going to make use of an image that will convey that in a way that everyone can understand. And what everyone understands is space and not, surprise, surprise, time, which is what drives the entire teaching of foreign languages, at least in Romance-based languages. It's all about time. And they're called tenses in English, but they're called tiempos, verbal times in Spanish, which is the biggest contradiction ever, because time is not a tangible concept. And time also will change according to culture, and time, you know, for us, the future is ahead, but for other cultures in Asia, the future is behind you because you can't see it. So working with time, it's not productive, it's not operative, and it brings confusion into the classroom because you say present. Okay, the present tense is for the present moment, and it's for right now. But that's not true at all, because the present can be used in the future. The present can be used in the past. The present can be used for counterfacts. So the present is everywhere. It can be used everywhere. So if you use the concept of time, your students and you, as a teacher, are going to be inevitably confused. But if you use space and your position in space to talk about time, then it works better. And actually, every teacher, every time we talk about time, we draw a line. So we are talking, it's inevitable to talk about time in terms of space. But what came first? Well, space was there, and then time came about, right? Or not, that's chicken or the egg. But it is easier to understand time in terms of space. To understand space in terms of time is confusing, and it's difficult. So what metaphors do, they facilitate comprehension and they facilitate relationships between different speakers, even in the same discourse community or a different discourse community. So if you, we're gonna use metaphors with our same discourse community, with the second language, the foreign language, and of course, and above everything, with the heritage language as well. So dominant, non-dominant, right? Metaphors help to explain how the world we live in works. A definition of what metaphorical competence is the ability to acquire, understand, and produce metaphors in a language, period. That is what competence is. But for the case of the L1, this ability is unconscious. You know, we're not aware that we're doing it, but we can develop it in the L3, L2, the foreign language concept context, by means of explicit instruction. And then this competence directly relates to communicative competence because it enables and motivates figurative language, thus contributing to a more natural understanding of the target language. So metaphorical competence is still not in the compendium of the literature of communicative competence. And there is literature on the communicative competence galore. And it's been going on since the 1970s, and there's still barely mention of this. It's a very, very recent and very timid conversation that is happening right now. But it makes a whole lot of sense because you are doing it unconsciously in your first language. You have a lot to say and you have a lot to bring to, as a learner, to the second or the foreign or the heritage language classroom if you're only allowed to do so. You're not coming to the classroom of the foreign language, you know, like you're entering a maze, and that you're trying to navigate that maze. No, you already have a GPS. So why don't we make use of a GPS in the language classroom by activating and explicitly teaching metaphorical competence and bringing this to the foreground of our pedagogy? So how does the metaphorical competence work? Let's see. There is something called conceptual metaphor. Are you familiar with this? Okay. Good. So conceptual metaphor is mental. It doesn't exist in language. It's just the language of your mind. And it is like a token that your mind has to try and bridge the gap between what it understands and what it can say. So that is a journey. Is one of the most pervasive conceptual metaphors ever. And it has become a linguistic metaphor. People say, oh, because love is a journey, but it's actually the language of the mind. So in love is a journey, you have a target domain, and that's the abstract. So what is love? Besides the title of a great song. What is love? Like, what does love mean? Because every speaker is unique, and every person is unique, and every person feels and understands the world in a different way. So how can you express love, which is so abstract, to other people, so that they understand what you mean? So you do that by activating what's called a source domain, which will provide concrete information about the world, something that's easy to understand, something that belongs to your encyclopedic knowledge, which is the knowledge that you have from basically being alive, and experimenting the world and relating to other people. So when you say love is a journey, then you create linguistic metaphors. And these are, yes, the relationship between language and thought. So this is the actual language that you use. So a conceptual metaphor, which is the language of the mind, will show up in your language with things such as, we're at a crossroads. Or in Spanish, estamos en una encrucijada. Or we've come a long way. In this relationship, we're not going anywhere. Tell me, where is this relationship going? In the age of Tinder, this is very, very frequent question these days. Or, you know, like with you, being with you is an adventure. So you conceptualize, you conceptualize love in terms of a journey, because everyone knows what a journey is. Even if you've never traveled before, you don't have a passport, you've gone to buy bread to the bakery. That's a journey already. So because it's based on experience, it comes up and it shows up in so many different linguistic expressions that we're not aware of. But what if we were? And what if for language learning we activated this kind of knowledge? Let me give you other conceptual and linguistic metaphors to illustrate this a little further. Let's see, time is money. That's another conceptual metaphor that is the language of your mind. What is time? Again, you know, it's so difficult. So let's talk about something everybody understands. We have more or less of it, but money talks. So we talk about wasting time, to saving time, the cost of time. We spend time with our friends. We are on borrowed time, or we invest time on something. And that way, by treating time as an active, as a liquid, as money, we come across as bridging the gap between the way we understand the world and the way others can understand our world. Another very pervasive conceptual metaphor is affection is temperature. So how do we conceptualize, again, affection and what it means to me when somebody's affectionate or somebody's not? Well, the temperature is something everyone understands. And you can be cold or hot, and everyone knows what that feels like, so let's go. You have a warm or a cold person, a warm welcome or a cool reception, it depends. You feel burning love, or you have a torrid affair. You give somebody the cold shoulder. So, as you can see, language is embodied, and language is metaphorical and experiential, and it arises from direct experience, physical experience with the world. Anger is a hot fluid in a pressurized container. That seems awfully specific, and like a little weird. So let me demonstrate with a graphic. I'm a very, very big fan of Pixar, and that will show up in this presentation later. But this is a semiotic, very visual representation of this conceptual metaphor of the mind, and then also in linguistic metaphors, it shows up as boiling blood, or to have a hot temper, to be boiling with rage, to explode from anger, to have simmering rage, and you use pressurized container, and you use the body as a container, you use emotions as temperatures, emotions, you know, feelings as things that you can feel on your skin. So they're everywhere. Bringing this into language learning and making students aware that this is happening helps them in a huge manner to bridge the gap between what they know and what they learn. I have it in here, so it will show up. So, more examples. I have reached my professional goals. Here we go. More. I have climbed the ladder of the corporate world. I have this very same slide at another talk I'm giving tomorrow. But the language is in Spanish. But it's categorize the world in a very similar manner. We just construe, we build with different words because we speak different languages, but the experiences and the human presence in the world is the same. So there's more to finding connection than in separation. Things just went downhill from there. Or easy target for criticism, you know, walking a tightrope, or I can't help you because my hands are tied, I'm buried in paperwork, if, you know, my semester just finished, I am buried in paperwork, I have so much grading to do, I'm so happy I'm here and not grading at home. Carry the weight of the world on my shoulders, so language is motivated, right? And we say I carry the weight of the world on my shoulders to convey, you know, pressure, gravity, weight, difficulty, pain, uncomfortable, like all of that to say I am so worried. And how can I convey my worry in the level, the epic level of worry to you? Well, I liken myself to Atlas. And that gives you a pretty good, you know, a pretty good impression of what I'm going through. So figurative language and language learning are worth it, but they're not, you know, we don't teach figurative language and it doesn't figure in our textbooks. When do we teach figurative language in the classroom? And tell me if this is not true. When you have 5 minutes left or 10 minutes left in the class and you're like, oh, I'm done with the lesson plan today. What can, guys, let's talk about idioms today. You know, or they come as a price, or like, you know, when they've done the midterm and then you have to fill one more class before, you know, spring break, and what do? You work on idioms. We do that. Or it's incidental input and the students say, hey, professora, what does it mean to say blah blah? And then you're like, oh, funny you ask. This is, you know, but you don't make a point of explicitly teaching figurative language, or you don't make a point of telling your students that everything is figurative language and that idioms are just a part of figurative language, but language is figurative all the time. So yeah, they help you see how the world, the linguistic world of a discourse community works. So I don't have the slide here, but English says to be pushing up the daisies when somebody, that's an idiom, right? When somebody dies, to be pushing up the daisies. Spanish has many of those too. One of them is estar criando malvas. And malvas are a type of flower that you see a lot of in cemeteries. And then any speakers of German here? German, right? German says sich die Blumen von unten angucken, which means to look at the flowers from below. So what do all of those idioms have in common? Well, pretty much that the body is a fertilizer. And when you die, you decompose and then you make flowers grow. Because you fertilize them. But, you know, to be pushing up the daisies has that. Estar criando malvas has to say, you know, to look at the flowers from below because you're, you know, making them grow. Hmm? So three idiomatic expressions that are completely different, but they relay the same conceptualization of the world. So the experiences are similar, the language is different. And that's for idioms. But everything that I've been talking about and all the examples that I've been giving you happen in all of our languages that we speak and that we teach. So there. Then what happens here is that talking or teaching figurative language and bringing it into language learning confirms the world knowledge of learners, and it doesn't leave them again feeling that they're learning a foreign language. They're just learning a language that says things differently. It's less foreign. It gives autonomy and confidence to learners, and it gives them a sort of detective-esque agency and quality in the classroom, and they find that they can understand a lot more, and they make inferences, and then suddenly in unit 16, in intermediate one, when they are talking about health and they learn the word mareado, dizzy, then suddenly they're like, oh, mareado from mar, from the sea, and you know, you get dizzy when you're in the ocean. So they start learning in a motivated manner and they start discovering motivation all the time. So this doesn't mean that they don't get to memorize vocabulary or that they don't get to, you know, have a quiz on that, but it makes memorization less taxing and it students are learning in a motivated way versus when they're just learning and memorizing this word means this. If they're bridging the gap between languages, it's just a much more, and in this case, regular motivation for the students. They just want to do it more. So the takeaways of metaphorical competence. So addressing idiomatic expressions is fun, but in general, figurative language in L2 learning through conceptual and linguistic metaphors gives structure and organization to the randomness that students perceive that is in their language curriculum and in their syllabus for learning both language, so grammar and vocabulary. So metaphorical competence gives meaningful, so makes learning meaningful. Students start getting interested in that, start understanding the inner workings of a language because they are cognitive representations of the physical world that we all know and experience. It creates bonds between the L1 and the L2, which, you know, our traditional colleagues don't like, but we can bring. If we are lucky enough to manage the same languages our students speak in the classroom, we can create a continuous discussion on what does your language do? What does Spanish do? How does this work? And they're like, oh, okay, so in my language we say this, but it's actually the same idea. And students' minds are blown in the Spanish classroom when they learn that the subjunctive exists just fine in English as well. There's just no specific morphology for it, but the conceptualization of the subjunctive mood is present and healthy and well in English as well. So it makes a lot more sense. It is a much more natural approach to language learning to bring the language that you know into the learning of the new one. And it doesn't make any sense to isolate. I know we are trying to create an immersion context, but that doesn't mean, that doesn't have to be mutually exclusive with, you don't want to teach in English. You don't want to teach Spanish and English, but you do want to, you know, align yourself with what the students know and, you know, enhance their ability to learn and to do critical thinking, which is, I think, huge. Yes. So everyone's a linguist in your class, and all of your students, it doesn't matter if it's elementary one or advanced three, they can do this. And because I teach all these levels, I know that this is possible to do. It allows students to establish reasoned connections between languages, and again, that is more natural than the, you know, the, now we're in the Spanish classroom, so it's only Spanish, and we don't do anything other than Spanish. And nobody talks about the cognitive overload of that. So it promotes linguistic reflection, and it normalizes that reasoning that they're still doing outside of your classroom anyway, so why don't you capitalize that in the language classroom itself? And this is a quote from Boris and Lindstromberg, who have an amazing, amazing book on cognitive linguistics and vocabulary and phraseology. So students who appreciate that language has considerable rhyme and reason may enjoy affective benefits such as heightened self-conscious. And this is very important for foreign language learners, but in the contextual case of the United States, this is huge for heritage language learners. And I believe that in Canada, Gigi was just saying that there is a large Spanish speaking community, so there's gotta be heritage speakers of Spanish in the classrooms here as well. So this is major for them. And cognitive linguistics can bridge the gap between foreign language learners and heritage language learners when they're mixed in your classrooms, because at least in the United States, at Columbia and many other high schools and universities, we get mixed classrooms. There are not enough classes for heritage language speakers alone, so we get them in our class. And the affective factors are huge in the heritage context. So this helps with that as well. So let's see, grammatical prototypes. They disrupt the understanding of the system. So what humans do, we categorize everything. We're always asking, do you like cats or dogs? Do you like the beach or the mountain? Do you want to go hiking or you want to go, to a resort? We categorize everything, and understanding and languages, they're not different. So prototypes, what they are is members in a category that, you know, because not all members are equals, there are some members that are more representative of a category. So if I tell you the category bird, you're going to think of a sparrow a lot easier or a lot faster than you're going to think of an ostrich, correct? All other members, so the members that are more prototypical, those are the ones that are more central and more representative of a category, for example, bird. And the others are more peripheral, that's what they're called, and they depend on extended semantic relationships that they're usually motivated by metonymies. Metaphors too, but mostly metonymies. If I tell you tree, if I tell you the word tree, imagine tree. Are you gonna think of this first or this? Probably this, unless you're from Jamaica or Costa Rica, which is why I talk about discourse communities and not native speakers. But if I tell you bird, you're probably gonna think of this one before you think of this one. Again, unless you're from Costa Rica. So, how am I with time? Am I okay?
You're fine.
Okay. So they're strongly dependent on discourse communities. And they vary inter-languages, but also intra-languages. So again, if you're from Colombia, you're gonna have, well, not from Bogota, but if you're from Cali, you're gonna have more affinity with this, maybe. But if you're from Spain, there's none of that. So, not only for nouns, and this is where it gets really, really cool and really, really interesting. They were the prototype word for all grammatical categories, and it makes teaching the indicative and the subjunctive, the imperfect and the preterite, prepositions, which is what we're going to briefly see here today, not a breeze, but much more manageable for the students and especially for yourself. If you teach Spanish and you've attempted the subjunctive and the indicative, you know how difficult that is and how complicated that is, and oh my god. And there's always, again, a hand that goes up, and you're like, no, please don't. When you have prototypes and you have a prototypical use for the indicative and a prototypical use for the subjunctive, then you can move from there. And what it looks like in language learning is like this. Like, you know, we just said that the categories are kind of diffuse and they don't have like very clear limits. So this wheel is not a perfect idea, but it works well with the prototype is at the center of it. For the subjunctive, there's gonna be a prototype. There's gonna be a core meaning. And then there are gonna be more peripheral uses of the subjunctive that are not directly traceable to the core, the prototype, but you can actually trace them because you have semantic extensions. And that is when you have a core meaning for the subjunctive, then you can apply it to relative clauses, to temporal clauses, to concessive clauses, to expressions of emotion or whatever. And they always work from here. And that way you can move through levels and through the intermediate one to intermediate two to advanced with the same prototype and always work from the same prototype. And then one semester you're here. But you can always go back to the center. So prototype theory applied to grammar in language learning is a huge advancement. So what do? They give systemic and motivated explanations. If I start by saying that the conditional is a tense of the past, it is a tense that is, in terms of space, there. Then you can start making connections throughout the entire syllabus and saying, okay, if there is here, then I'm gonna have a counterfactual situation because there is there. But if I bring it to the here, then I don't make it an actual thing. And that's why you get, if I were you, then I would do blah, blah. Because that I would do, it's an approximation of things. Or then you get the pragmatics of courtesy, because courtesy is distance. So if you take a there and bring it to the here and give it to somebody, you're putting distance between yourself and that person. So it makes sense that the conditional would be used for courtesy reasons. And then when you get to the, um, to the indirect speech, there's no aha moment. There's just like, okay, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So you create a more holistic approach. So the sheer memorization is then reduced. And I put that in quote unquote because they still have to memorize. Again, this is not magic. It's pretty cool, but it does not exempt anyone from memorizing and from taking tests. So because meaning is based on physical spatial observations, then radial extensions, these semantic extensions, become more visible. They become tangible and they become understandable for the learners. And then again, it bridges gaps between the languages that the students speak. And what it makes is all those rules, it's a more user-friendly approach, and there's not rules and 250 exceptions. There's an actual book about the subjunctive in Spanish that has 73 exceptions to rules. 73, I counted them for my dissertation, so yes, 73. So there's the rule, and then 73 cases in which the rule doesn't work. So wouldn't that make you think that the rule doesn't work? Well, no, apparently no. So the semantic networks are also gestalt-based, which means that there's a lot that has to do with perception and what's foregrounded and backgrounded in communication. And that has to do with visual rubrics, which is also very consistent with what we're already doing in the foreign language classroom, where we're trying to represent things visually so that students make a form meaning connection. Because with the way they're teaching and they're receiving the teaching of grammar, they're not making those form meaning connections. So because they are gestalt-based and they're based on perception and understanding, it's easier for the students to take linguistic form and assign meaning to it. So it's a lot easier for the students to start producing the subjunctive more freely, or to start attempting at conjugating the imperfect and the preterite while telling a story in a more motivated manner. And by motivated, I mean cognitive linguistics motivated. Like, they have a communicative intent, and then they select the tense that goes with that intent. Excuse my stick figures. You know, you get me, don't you? Yeah, there we go. So the verb llevar in Spanish can be translated as to wear, to carry, or it's also time and duration. So yo llevo un vestido, I wear a dress. Or yo llevo mi, whatever this is called, with me all the time. Or how long have you been teaching? So cuánto llevas enseñando? So you kind of wear the teaching with you. So there's no way those three things have anything in common, but they do. They do have a physical point of contact. One of them is literal, or two of them are literal, and the other one is metaphorical. So you wear a dress. The dress is a point of contact with your body, or you carry something. There is a definite point of contact. This is more prototypical, this is a little more peripheral, and this is completely figurative. You carry something, like you carry a relationship. How long have you been with your boyfriend? I've been with my boyfriend for a year and a half. So I carry my relationship with me. So I have a figurative physical point of contact with that profession or with that relationship. So this is a motivated explanation of three vocabulary terms that also are learned in three different levels, usually. They don't appear at the same time. But what if they could? You know, I tell my elementary students all the time, you guys have elementary knowledge of Spanish, but you don't have elementary minds. You understand this. You get it because you have the same physical experiences. So elementary level of a language doesn't mean elementary level of understanding. So, case of prepositions. Do I have 5 minutes?
Two.
I have 2 minutes. Sure, okay. So there's already in English an aim to move towards a motivated explanation for English. This is for Spanish. We have poripara and we have prepositions of forward motion. So what we do is create a core meaning for prepositions that is, of course, based in space, based on space. So we have the spatial explanation, sort of, schematic explanation, and then we go to more peripheral uses for past and future, for instance. But if you guys teach Spanish, then you know that poripara, so for and to, there's like 25 different uses for each, and they overlap a lot. So this, we considerably. And that's what I've done with my students, but this is in advanced Spanish what my students do by themselves. Again, poripara. And because I do this with them, they're ready to come and create their own schematic explanations of the prepositions. So that works. And also in advanced Spanish, this is what they do. That's Don Quixote and Sancho, and they're going towards the windmill. So, you know, they get creative, but they get the spatial meaning. And when they use spatial explanations, they get to understand the core, and then they start extending, and it makes a lot more sense for them to say, oh, that's why they're using this, that's why they're using that. There are some textbooks that are already making attempts at this, also with like against or like towards or from and to the preposition to in general. There's still, you know, a large list, but it's motivated by one visual rubric that has a spatial core meaning. So concepts from cognitive linguistics for prepositions, you have the spatial nature, you have the embodied experience, you have force dynamics, which is the coolest term ever in cognitive linguistics for who does what to whom. You have metaphorical thinking, you have construal, which is the way you express things in the language that you have. And everything is related, and there are connections between all of these things instead of having lists of usages. And also, there is very little, I don't know in French and I don't know in English, but in Spanish, there is barely any instruction on prepositions by themselves. You learn prepositions in Unit 7, again, an elementary one, when you are doing directions, but other than that, you've been using prepositions since day one with the students, but you expect them to know, because they're very similar, but they're not. So again, same thing as with the motion and the to go up and subir, there's got to be explicit instruction or students don't learn. There's got to be motivated instruction. So, Pixar in cognitive linguistics, you've seen Brave? Well, this was, her hair was representative, was semiotic of how crazy and like free-spirited she was. Well, this is the same. If we use metaphorical knowledge and metaphorical competence to express visually or figuratively what we mean, then it's more motivated, and then you don't need so much instruction. Students can do that by themselves because they already know how to do this. And my favorite thing ever, simplicity, look at the prototype that then became more like this. Those wonderful monsters, but there's gotta be a spatial origin of things. So the simplicity of grammatical prototypes, what it lends is validate the bilingual nature approach to language learning, meta-language reduces meta-language and amplifies the know-how of the language, again, because it brings what they already can do. And I think we're done. Thank you so much.